Mr. President, Prime Minister, guests, thanks all for having me here. Little awkward. I have no pretense of being any kind of expert on the Icelandic economy. I'm doing my best to get up to speed when here. The title I put on here is a bit of a joke, partly a literary joke, if you read fantasy fiction, but also refers to something that was thought to be a sick joke back in early 2009. In early 2009, it was a popular joke in Ireland to say, oh, what's the difference between Ireland and Iceland? And the answer would be one letter. Ha, 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 because no way could Ireland do as badly as Iceland. The reason I've been focusing on Iceland is not sad to say because of special interest in the country, though it is lovely and wonderful, but because it's a useful comparator case. What we had, just to take the broader context here, we had it within the European, within Europe. Considering Iceland as part of it, you had a massive capital outflows from the European core to a number of peripheral countries during most of the last decade, and then an abrupt collapse of those capital flows. And the response in almost all of the affected countries was pretty much a hardline policy of fiscal austerity and relying on internal devaluation, relying upon a fall in domestic prices and wages to adjust to that cutoff of capital flows. And Iceland is the exception for a variety of reasons. Iceland was different. Iceland zigged when the conventional wisdom and the actual policy in all the countries that you might regard as comparators was that you should zag. So Iceland is relevant because it's to some extent a test, or it's a control. Life being as it is, economics being as it is, it's by no means a perfect control by a long shot. Every country is different. Iceland was awesome in the scale of the craziness, and as we all know, there's typically just, you know, if you go back 3 years, when people wanted to tell stories about the excesses of the financial crisis, if you wanted to make a movie like Inside Job or the first place Michael Lewis was going to go to report on the peculiar habits of the natives, they would always start with Iceland. So it's not a clear example of what you would want as a comparator. And there are structural differences. This is a very small economy, and that's it. In thinking about some things like exports, you really need to bear in mind how small and how undiversified it actually is. Nonetheless, it's a case. So Ireland was supposed to be the ultimum ultimorum of the crisis. Iceland was supposed to be, nobody could be worse than Iceland. And the immediate observation is that it hasn't quite worked out that way. So I think of it as, you know, why not the worst? Why is, if we look at Iceland, look at the unemployment performance, it is, of course, actually far less severe than that of the countries you would normally consider as comparators. And we heard quite a lot about that and related issues early in this session. Some people do say, oh, it's just because everybody left that's emigration, but it's not true. So you can actually look at the employment indicators. What you see is that Iceland is, once again, this is not a stirring slogan. Not as bad as you might have expected is not kind of the slogan on which a politician wants to run an election campaign. But the truth is that Iceland is not remotely as bad as you might have expected. And it's also particularly, given the kinds of debates some of us find ourselves in a world in which U.S. opinion columnists say America can learn from Latvia, which really shows how it should be done, it is kind of interesting to notice what's actually happened on the employment front. GDP is a little bit less clear, but one of the things I've learned, by the way, a word to everybody doing research here, is with small economies, you really need to be careful about what GDP means. Ireland, increase in pharma production raises GDP, but it basically employs no people and the capital is foreign owned, so it doesn't quite mean what you might think it means. What do we actually So I think of there being two major policy controversies on which the Icelandic experience and the experience of the other extreme capital inflow and sudden stop countries give us some information. One of them is the issue of, is internal devaluation a workable strategy? If you were part of the original discussions, should we have a euro? Should there be a single European currency? Part of the question was, well, suppose that you have asymmetric shocks. Suppose that there is, in fact, a need for adjustment. And to a certain extent, the answer of euro enthusiasts 20 years ago was, we will have sound policies, so there will be no asymmetric shocks, which doesn't turn out to be how it worked. But then the answer is, we're going to have labor market flexibility. And so we'll be able to have to regain competitiveness through wage and price flexibility. I barely meant to, just to say that the Icelandic story is an insignificant part. There's a huge external adjustment. That's what supported the economy. It is primarily on the import side. I'll talk about that in a bit. But let me just give you this. What have we actually seen about wage flexibilities? We just had a discussion about labor market flexibility and what we can achieve. This is Ireland. So the line at the top is Ireland in kroner, and the line at the bottom is Iceland. I'm doing it too. Iceland in kroner, Iceland in euros, and of course Iceland has achieved a large cut in wages in euro terms thanks to the depreciation. What is striking, to me at least, is looking at countries that are now held up as examples of successful internal devaluation, countries that have actually made the adjustment. So we hear about Ireland saying they're doing okay, they're really making the adjustment. What that means is that so far, in the face of sustained 14% unemployment, nominal wages have fallen by about 5%. We hear Latvia extolled, and Latvia needs to be careful. There were huge cuts in the pay to public employees, but the Latvian private sector, hardly any downward wage adjustment. Now, as long as there is rising wages in your trading partners, this can accumulate over time to adjustment. But anyone who wanted to have faith that properly flexible labor markets would make internal devaluation an easy option should be deeply disheartened by what you saw. Has not played out as expected. The other question, of course, is debt. How orthodox must one be? Do you have to assume responsibility for the liabilities that your banks ran up? And everyone's been, this is from the OECD. The numbers haven't changed very much. Obviously, Iceland has done fine in terms of regaining not total, but reasonable confidence in its sovereign debt. So the idea that there would be a huge reputational penalty for allowing private sector creditors to go bust and default on their external obligations has not turned out to be true. So listening to this talk, to the previous discussion, it occurred to me that I really need to talk in the 6 minutes and 19 seconds I have left. I need to talk about three issues. First is, why, given all of this, is Iceland not doing better? Why are we not seeing something like Argentina after the 2002 crisis? Why aren't we seeing a spectacular rebound? At least as I understand it, there's really three things, which are fish, aluminum, and debt. When we talk about exports from Iceland, you know, two-thirds of it is fish and aluminum, both of which are subject essentially to physical constraints. In the case of fish, there's only so many fish that you can harvest. In the case of aluminum, capacity, which is a long, long lead times. So one should not have expected a huge surge in real exports. It just can't happen that quickly. Debt is the big issue. Huge overhang of private, of household and corporate debt. All I can say is with the problems of indexation either to the CPI or to foreign exchange, I will say I find that story rather disheartening because I think of the U.S. context. And Iceland, by U.S. standards, has incredible openness and willingness to seeking debt relief. And even so, it's extremely difficult. And I think this is something one can hope will proceed, but it's a very hard thing to do. Capital controls. That's, I think, where we have a real issue here. I think it's fairly remarkable that so many of the people we've heard today and so many of the people we speak to are quite sure that one can safely liberalize capital quite soon. Maybe, but it sure looks as if this is a pretty unstable situation if hot money was free to move again. And given the indexation of the debt and the great difficulty of resolving those debt issues, you have to have a great deal of confidence that you would not have a real plunge in the currency. So I find it, people say, well, the original statement was it would only last a few months. Well, yeah, a lot of things were said in the crisis that have turned out to be not remotely right in all countries involved. Last thing, and this is, I think, on the issue of joining the euro. Bear in mind what I just showed you, which is that internal devaluation, that system of adjustment, has basically proved to be, if not a total failure, far, far less successful than optimists would have predicted. And that's been true everywhere. It's been true even in the countries that are being typed as stellar examples of internal devaluation. It's just not working. So or it's working very slowly with intense pain. So if your argument is that, well, we can make this work, we can adjust to future imbalances through wage and price flexibility, it'd basically be the first country in the history of mankind to do that. It just doesn't seem to actually happen. Now, I think the contrary argument, the other argument we've been hearing, is that, but if Iceland was on the euro or had a fixed exchange rate, that there would not be these extreme swings of capital inflows and then sudden stops. And I think if you look only at the Icelandic situation, you may be able to convince yourself that it was the floating rate that produced the radical swings. But if you look around a little bit, it was by no means unique. If you look around, you see that comparable size, vast inflows of capital relative to GDP, followed by sudden stops, were, it's a whole menu of countries. Just on a quick count, I found that Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Bulgaria, and Cyprus are all basically in the same league as Iceland in terms of the scale of the capital inflows and then the abrupt cutoff. All of those were fixed rate, and in the case of Estonia, a credible, as it turns out, commitment to join the euro. That didn't seem to insulate them. So if you say the carry trade is driven only by having the floating exchange rates, it's not true. These vast inflows and then sudden stops were a feature pretty much regardless of exchange regime. And if we're looking at bigger economies, so Spain is not going to look as a share of GDP, the numbers are not so large, but it's a much bigger economy. Spain is nonetheless whipsawed by extremely large capital inflows and an abrupt sudden stop. And by the way, while following what appeared to be highly responsible fiscal policies. In retrospect, given what we now know, not so, but it looked like it was praised at the time, as was Ireland. So coming back to this, I really wonder about this enthusiasm for a quick joining of the euro, because on a lot of dimensions, Iceland's post-crisis seems to illustrate the advantages of having a flexible currency. It seems to me rather perverse to look at the situation and say, gee, we want to ditch this currency, which has made it possible for us to not rely on internal devaluation and instead rely on devaluation instead. That seems rather odd. And lots of critiques you can make of the policy choices that were made. But I think the striking thing, again, is given what one might have expected, given it's December 2008 and you're looking at the world, how would you think that Iceland would stack up among the ranks of countries in trouble? And I don't think you would have expected it to be anywhere near as mild relative to the other crisis countries, as it has turned out to be. Thanks.